Nothing that we can do effectively in ministry or any other place in our life without his intervention. Amen. We're just flesh. And that which is flesh is nothing more than that. But you know, it's amazing when God puts his hand on someone, what can be accomplished through their life if they will just submit their life to Jesus. And that's what I want to do. If I know my heart tonight, I want to be a servant of God. Nothing more than a servant. It's an amazing thing about the economy of God. You see, in the world, everybody pushes, and to get ahead, they step on one another and hurt one another. But in God's kingdom, it works just the opposite. If you do that, you may think you're getting ahead, but the further you plunge ahead, the further away from success you really are.
Amen.
But if you humble yourself, the Bible said that God will exalt you. Amen.
Yeah.
And I just want to be a servant of God. There's no greater calling than to be a servant of God.
Amen.
Amen. this place. I'm here to say I'm nothing. I was a sinner, but now I'm saved.
Father, we would certainly bow our hearts before your presence tonight. We thank you, God, for the word of God that, Lord, you've given. We thank you, Lord, that it's the very breath of God that we hold in our hand. The same breath that hung the worlds in their place tonight, that, Lord, this earth spins on the axles of God of thy breath. God, we're just grateful tonight, Lord, for the word. And thank you, God, Lord, the word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Yes. We beheld its glory, the glory of the only begotten Son of God. Lord, tonight, God, I'm glad, Lord, for the day that it brought me to a place of conviction, God, that I could see myself as a sinner going to hell, God, lost, left, God. Lord, I'm just grateful to you tonight. And I pray, God, Lord, for a few moments of our time tonight, God, that you let us sit, God, in a heavenly place tonight. God, as the man of God, Lord, comes to preach, God, I pray you'd fill him with the Spirit of God. Lord, Lord, I pray, God, you would anoint his lips oppressed tonight, his mind, give him that he needs tonight. May he not be afraid to preach, God, but may, God, he just mind the Spirit of God and the leadership of God as he preaches, God, Lord, your word tonight. Help us, we pray. God, I pray if there's a sinner here tonight, this lost, left, God, that you would arrest their soul tonight and draw them to yourself. God, I pray for that kind of power, God, to illuminate the mind and the heart, God, of those that are lost, left, God. Lord, I know that we live in a time where the conscience is, Lord, been seared by a lot of people tonight. But God, I pray for the penetrating power of the blood of the Lord Jesus tonight. God would come to this place and God bring great conviction here tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you for praying for us, Brother Danny. Good to see everybody in the service this evening. We had great attendance last night. Pastor challenged the church to invite others to come. I believe we got more people here tonight than we did last night. So thank you so much for being in this service tonight. Thank you so much for the songs. Dale's wonderful tonight. Appreciate the congregationals and the special music. And pray the Lord bless all of you for being here. Appreciate Brother Jeremy being back with us. Yeah. And And thank you, Brother Danny, for coming and being with us, and also Brother Eric Justice. Appreciate you men being in service, and our other preacher tonight, J.R., or he also goes by Junior. And so thank you for coming tonight, brother. Appreciate you very much. Hebrews chapter number 2. I mentioned last evening that tonight I will speak from the book of Hebrews, chapter number 2. I'm going to be reading verses in chapter 2 to make my first point, and then we will go to Hebrews 5 to make the second point, and then we'll finish our third point in Hebrews 9. So we'll begin tonight in Hebrews chapter number 2. It is a privilege to stand before you. Every time I stand to preach, I know and I feel that God has called me to do an impossible task. Every preacher that's called by God understands that God has called him to do something that he cannot do. I understood when God called me to preach that he was calling me to do something that I was incapable of doing. And I felt my smallness and my weakness. And I've been doing it for a long time, and I've done it a lot of times, and I've done it in a lot of different places. But I still cry out with Paul in 2 Corinthians when he said, "Who is sufficient for these things?" And I understand tonight that in my flesh, my own abilities, that I will fail, I always fail, and that we do need the power of the Holy Ghost to do through us what we as men cannot do. And that is speak to your heart,
yes,
teach you his word, convict you, save you, sanctify you.
Amen.
These are works that only God can do for us.
Yeah.
I pray that he will tonight. I'm preaching these three nights on the subject of Gospel 101. Gospel 101. And that word gospel means what?
Good news.
Gospel is good news. Not just good advice. Not good myths, but good news. And what is news? Well, here's what it's supposed to be. It's the clear announcement and reporting of what has happened, what God has done. Good news of what God has done for us in Jesus. And I said last night about the gospel that I am a gospel preacher.
Amen.
I believe that's what God has called me to do, what God has sent me to do, to preach the gospel to the lost and to the saved,
yes,
to those outside the church and those inside the church.
Amen.
When my home church licensed me 31 years ago, preach, it says on my license that I was licensed by the Cary Springs Baptist Church to preach the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. After that, when they ordained me, they gave me a certificate of ordination. And on my certificate of ordination, it says that the Cary Springs Baptist Church ordained me to preach the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is my heart and desire to be a gospel preacher, to announce the good news. And I said last night that the gospel is 25 things. It has taken me over 30 years to nail these 25 things down. I'm still learning about the gospel. I still study the gospel every day of my life and ask God to teach me things about his glorious gospel that I've not known before, so that I can keep preaching and teaching these glorious truths to people who will listen. And I believe there are 25 truths that make up the gospel, and I'm sharing them with you over these three nights. And this is the way I break it down. Number one, the gospel is seven events. That's what I preached on last night. The gospel is made up of seven events. The gospel is the news of Jesus Christ's birth, his life, his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, and his second coming. That's seven events. It takes all seven of those events in the life of Christ to save us sinners.
Amen.
Not just one of those events, or two, or just three of those events. Death, burial, and resurrection takes all seven, because they all make up a chain link of events forged in the person and work of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
His birth, his life, his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, his second coming. And that's what I'm trusting and believing.
Yes. Amen.
Nothing that I have done, no work that I have done for him, but this sevenfold work that he has done for me and my salvation. The gospel is seven events. Now, tonight I want you to see that the gospel is 16 effects. Now, I told you last night, I preach 45 minutes. That's just what I do. I'm a 45-minute preacher. I just want to remind you of that, because if a preacher said, I'm going to talk to you about 16 things, it'll give people a heart attack and a bad shirt. I'll be grouping those 16 things under three headings. We can get three things. Those seven events, those seven gospel events, produce 16 gospel effects in those who are saved. Are you saved tonight?
Amen.
My second question is, what does it mean to be saved tonight? What does that mean? When someone asks you, are you saved? Most people today in America, especially here in the South, are going to say, yes, they are. If you were then to turn around and ask them, well, what does it mean to be saved? What does it mean that you are saved? Most people would have no idea.
Right.
That's
exactly
right. The 16 effects of the gospel are what it means for you and I to be saved. In the New Testament, I count at least 16 gospel doctrines that tell us what it means for you and I who are saved to be saved. These 16 things are what salvation is. Okay. 16 gospel doctrines, 16 gospel effects. Because of what Jesus did in those seven events have 16 profound, saving, life-changing effects upon us. So here's what I want to do. In a minute and a half, I want to mention them 16 things.
Yeah.
I want to encourage you to study those 16 things. I try to preach and teach on those 16 things. And all 16 of these doctrines, words, terms, are what the New Testament uses to describe God's saving work in our lives. Now, don't let the first one scare you. Now, that scares some people to death. Don't let it scare you. It's a Bible word pertaining to our salvation. It's the word election. I'm not a Calvinist, and I'm not an Arminian. I ain't neither one. But I'm not afraid of the fact that the Bible uses the word election.
Amen.
Pertaining to our salvation. That's a gospel doctrine. Number two, calling. Our calling. Over and over in the New Testament describes what we call Christians as those who were called.
Man,
those that God called.
Yeah. Yeah.
We refer to this as Holy Ghost conviction, the drawing power of the Spirit, convicting us of our sin, bringing us to Jesus Christ. Election, calling. Truths like substitution. We mentioned that last night, that Jesus died in our place. He gave himself for us. Substitution.
Yeah.
Number four, the truth of identification. That when he was born, and when he lived, and when he died, when he was buried, when he arose, when he ascended, when he comes again, He has identified with us in all of those things, and in salvation, God has identified us in Christ, so that his birth is my birth.
Yeah, amen.
His life is my life. His death is my death. Burial, mine. Resurrection, my resurrection. Ascension is my ascension. Right now, I'm seated together with him in heavenly places. His second coming for me, that's mine. Identification. There, of course, is the wonderful truth of spiritual union, that when God saved me, he put me into Christ and Christ into me. Union.
Amen.
Amen. Imputation, that Jesus imputed all of his righteousness unto me, as all of my sins were imputed unto him. Imputation.
Amen.
Survival. Justification. Thank God I am declared righteous in Jesus Christ. Justification. Sanctification. I have been set apart and declared holy by God Almighty. Sanctification. Glorification.
Amen.
Amen. There is regeneration. I am born again. There is adoption. I have been adopted by the Father into his family.
Amen.
There is propitiation. The wrath of God is forever satisfied towards me. There is forgiveness of sins. Forgiveness. That's a gospel truth. That's a gospel doctrine. Amen. There is another gospel word, conversion. Conversion. It means to take something that is twisted and gnarled up and to straighten it out and make it straight and right. There's the gospel truth of the redemption. I am redeemed. I have been set free. I have been bought with a price. And I have been set free. Redemption. There, of course, is the word reconciliation. That's a gospel doctrine, a gospel word. That's what it means to be saved. I am reconciled into a right relationship with God. How many is that? Is that about 16? Did I miss one? That's how many gospel words, doctrines, I have tried through the years to preach on all of these doctrines and even to preach series is on these gospel words, these gospel doctrines.
Amen.
That is the gospel. Are you saved? Here's how you know. Are these 16 truths, these 16 gospel truths and doctrines, a reality in your life?
Amen.
When you believe savingly on those 17 events, 16 effects come into your life. That's what it means to be saved.
Amen. Amen.
And I'll say three things about those 16 things and I'll be done. Let's simplify. Number one, for me tonight to say that I am saved is to say tonight that I have been saved and that these 16 effects of the gospel have happened to me at some point in my life in the past. When did you get saved? When did you come to know the Lord? When did you believe the gospel to the saving of your soul? To quote later in Hebrews 10. When did that happen to you? You have not just always been saved. Are you listening to me? If you are saved tonight, S-A-V-E-D, past tense, it means that at some point, some place in time in your life, you believed those seven things that Jesus did to save you, and those 16 effects happened in your life, and they happened simultaneously the moment that you believed. This April will be 38 years ago that I believed what Jesus Christ did to save me. And all 16 of those effects happened in my life. Let's read about it in Hebrews chapter number 2, beginning at verse 7. And here's what I want you to be paying attention to.
I said last night when I got done with those seven things, I was going to show you how those seven things saved us and how that those seven events bring these effects into our life. Now I want you to pay attention to the wording here in Hebrews 2. And I want you to pay attention that some of the words that I used as to gospel doctrines are used in the text. And I want you to pay attention in the text of how that Jesus' birth, his life, his death, his burial, his resurrection, and ascension are all referred to right here in Hebrews. I didn't mention the second coming. I'll get to that one in a little bit. Hebrews 2, verse number 7. Thou madest him a little lower than the angels. That is his birth. That is the incarnation. Are you with me? Verse 7 says, thou crownedest him with glory and honor and didst set him over the works of thy hands. That is his ascension. Okay? We have gone from the birth of Christ to the ascension of Christ. Right there in one verse, verse 7. Verse 8 continues on the truth of the ascension of Christ. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet, for in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him, but now we see not yet all things put under him. This is talking about when Jesus ascended up on the throne, ascended up to heaven and sat down on the throne of God. All things are put under his feet, but not all things have yet recognized his authority, but they will.
Amen.
Verse 9 says, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, back to his birth, for the suffering of death. Now we have gone to his death. Crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. For it became him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. Notice verse number 14 says, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part, not all, part of the same, that through death, the first part of verse 14 talking about the incarnation, bringing us then to his death, verse 14, through death, he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. This, of course, brings us to his death, his burial, and his resurrection. That's verse number 14 and 15. Verse 16, for verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Right back to his birth again. Verse 17, wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. Verse 17 and 18, bringing us back full scale and circle to his ascension. To his ascension. Now, quickly tonight, here's what I want to say about what we just read. And that is, the writer of Hebrews is taking the first five events of the gospel. All right? What we would call the finished work of Jesus Christ. He mentions five things in our text that Jesus has done for us. He has already done for us. He has done these things for us in the past. These are past works that have past effect on our life, and we often call it the finished work of Jesus Christ. Are you with me? 38 years ago, These works of Jesus Christ were made real in me, and 16 saving effects happened in my life. And I can tell you tonight, that was 38 years ago. I am saved. I have been saved ever since. I am still saved tonight by the finished work of Jesus Christ. Amen. And as to my position tonight, I'm as saved as I can possibly be. I am saved.
Amen.
I'm all the way saved.
Yeah,
I can't be more saved than what I am as to what happened to me 38 years ago this April. I am saved. And 38 years ago, when God saved me, listen to me tonight, what He saved in me was my spirit. Now, according to Paul in 1 Thessalonians 5:23, human beings are made up of three parts, spirit, soul, and body, in that order. And God's first saving work in me 38 years ago was that He saved my spirit, completely saved my spirit. The spirit inside of me has been saved.
Right. Amen.
So tonight, to properly understand what it means to be saved is for me to understand that what happened to me 38 years ago when God saved me was simply this: God saved me with eternal salvation. I said eternal salvation. Hebrews chapter number 5 says of Jesus, He is the author of eternal salvation for all who obey Him. 38 years ago, God did an eternal work in me that was spiritual.
Amen.
Yeah. An eternal work in me that was spiritual.
Right.
Now, I'm preaching from the book of Hebrews, but if you want to jot down some scriptures for further study, you will find in places like Romans 3, Romans 5, 1 Corinthians 1, 1 Corinthians 6, Titus 3. Many of these 16 things that I've mentioned, all thrown together and grouped together in one. Now, I've not found a place in the Bible where all 16 are used in the scope of two or three verses. But you will find 9 or 10 of them mentioned here, and then you'll find 6 or 7 of them over here, all grouped together. So I've just given you some chapters that would be great to study where you see these things coming together. And theologians have been arguing for many centuries over a phrase. It's a Latin phrase they call the Ordo Salutis. In English, that means the order of salvation. The order of salvation.
Yes,
and when they argue over the order of salvation, they all recognize these 16 things happen to us when we get saved. But they argue over what order they happen in when we get saved. Now, what happens first? Y'all with me? That's a big discussion. I preach on that a long time. And I do believe that if you study the New Testament carefully, it will give us some sense of an ordo salutis, or order of salvation, and how these things happen to us, and some ordering of how or when they happen. However, let's never forget in our experience, in our personal experience, the day we get saved, the moment we get, the moment we savingly believe on Jesus, all 16 things happen to us and it is done.
Amen.
Amen. It is done. Alright? So in the finished work of Jesus, what is His finished work? His birth, His life, His death, His burial, His resurrection, His ascension, and seat on the throne of God. That is finished and done. Are you with me?
Amen.
And it has produced 16 effects that happened to me 38 years ago and happened to you if you're really saved at the moment that you believe.
Amen.
Okay? Now here's the second thing I want you to see. I have said that these 16 things, these 16 effects, or these 16 gospel works, gospel doctrines, they have a past effect. I said 16 effects. Their effects are past in my life.
But number two, I want you to see they're also present effects in my life. They're present effects in my life. Okay. 38 years ago, God saved me and gave me eternal salvation that was spiritual. But over the last 38 years, those past effects have had a continuous, ongoing, present effect in my life. I was saved and I am saved, and I know that I was saved and am saved because I'm still being saved.
Right. Amen.
Now, God wasn't done saving me when He saved me 38 years ago.
Right. Yeah.
All right. Right. 38 years ago, He gave me eternal spiritual salvation. But over the last 38 years, He's been giving me eternal and gradual continual salvation.
Right. Yeah.
I want you to turn to Hebrews chapter number 7.
Amen.
All right. I have talked to you about the finished work of Jesus in salvation. What His finished work, what did He finish? Here's what He, His birth, that's finished. He's not going to do that again. His life, His earthly life, keeping the law, His active obedience, His achieved righteousness, that is finished. His death, never to die again, burial, never to be resurrection, never to be buried again, His ascension into heaven, it is done, it is all finished tonight.
Amen.
But now I'm going to talk to you about the unfinished work of Jesus Christ. When we say His finished work concerning those seven events, five of those things are finished. Okay? And two of those things are not yet finished. There are some things that Jesus has done that He's never going to do again, and some things of those seven that Jesus is still doing right now, and one of those things that He's going to do someday in the future, we're hoping ain't too long from now.
Yeah. Amen.
Are you with me?
Yeah.
All right, so here's what you need to understand about the book of Hebrews. The book of Hebrews is about Jesus' ascension at the right hand of God in heaven, or what we call the entirety of His ascension and ascension work that's been going on for 2,000 years. His birth, life, death, burial, resurrection happened all within the scope of 33 years. But His ascension for us involves a work that has gone on for 2,000 years. Are you with me? And it's still going on tonight. Did y'all get that? He not only did something to save me 2,000 years ago over the space of 33 years, He's been doing something to save me and keep me saved and go on saving me for 2,000 years, and He's doing it right there from the throne of God where He sits.
Right, right.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
So in the book of Hebrews, it gives us some special titles for Jesus and what He's doing to save His people right now in the present tense. In the book of Hebrews, He is called our great high priest. He is also called our anchor. He is called our surety. He is called our intercessor and our mediator. He is referred to as the shepherd and the bishop of our souls. And all of those titles given to Him are titles given to Him to describe what He's doing for His people right now in His great saving work for us. What's Jesus doing on His throne? He's saving all of His people. What's He doing in His ascension and session at the right hand of the Father? He's saving those whom He has saved.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter number 7. Are you there? If you are, say amen.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter number 7. If you would, notice two verses here, please. 24 and 25. Hebrews 7, 24 and 25. 24, but this man, talking about Jesus.
Yes.
Because He continueth ever. This is ongoing. This is right now. Because He continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood.
Amen.
Wherefore, He is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by Him, seeing He ever liveth to make intercession for them. Hold on, let me get this straight. Jesus is sitting on the throne of God, the ascended enthroned Christ is sitting
on that throne tonight. As our anchor, surety, intercessor, mediator, our advocate, our bishop, our shepherd. And if I just read this right, this is what he's doing for us.
Yeah, amen.
He is saving us unto the uttermost. Have you come to God by him tonight? Here's what he's doing for you right now. He's saving you.
Amen.
All right, did you get that? 38 years ago, I got a salvation that's eternal and spiritual. Since then, I've been getting a salvation that's internal and gradual. God did not quit saving me when he saved me. That's how I know he saved me.
Amen.
I now want you to think about them 16 things that I mentioned. Kind of got that back on your mind? See, some of those 16 things that I mentioned happened to me the moment I got saved. They don't happen to me again. That's it. The minute I got saved, I was justified. I cannot be any more justified than what I already am.
Amen.
The moment God saved me, are you listening to me? I got regenerated. I got born again. You can't get born again again. Are you with me? And those 16 effects, I experienced all of them 38 years ago. And some of them I experienced 38 years ago. And that was that, and you ain't going to experience them again. You can't get more of it, you already got it. But now there are some of those things in the New Testament that it describes, which happened to me 38 years ago, but also says still happen to me right now. Things like sanctification. Did I get sanctified 38 years ago? Yes, I did. Heard Baptist preachers say all my life, now there's a big difference between salvation and sanctification. I don't know where they got that from. They didn't get it from the Bible.
Amen.
Somebody show me from the Bible the big difference between salvation and sanctification. And I'll show you 14 times in the King James New Testament where those two terms are used together and interchangeably as the same thing.
Amen.
Back there in Hebrews 2 was one of them. 38 years ago, I got sanctified. For 38 years, I've been getting sanctified.
Amen. Amen.
You with me?
Amen.
Y'all get that? What about forgiveness? 38 years ago, I was forgiven. But I'm going to tell you, I've needed a lot more forgiveness over the last 38 years. What about you? You get all the forgiveness you needed? 38? As to my position, I did.
All right?
Listen to me now. 38 years ago, I've already mentioned it. My position was set. That's the finished work of Christ. Finished in me. That's my position before him. It's done. It's settled. All right? But for 38 years, his salvation has been working on my condition, and my condition don't always match my position.
Amen. 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 Good preaching. Yes, sir.
All right. So the last 38 years, all the way to this day, the man standing before you needs more saving. I need more sanctified. That's a saving word. I need more forgiveness. That's a saving word. I need more converting. You remember what? Remember what Jesus said to Simon Peter over in the upper room back there in Luke chapter number 22? He's already converted. He's a saved man. But Jesus said, now when you're converted, strengthen your brethren.
Yeah.
38 years ago, God straightened me out, and he's been straightening me out ever since. You still got some crooked in you, still got some warped things in you, still got something bent in you. He's still working on me.
Hallelujah.
I have a series on sanctification. I title it this, How God Saves Saved People. That's what sanctification is. Are you with me? That's how God saves saved people. When God saved you, he ain't done with you.
Amen.
There's still a whole lot of saving that the Lord intends to do in us.
Amen.
All right? As to my position, I got it all. I got every bit of it. All you can get of it, I got 38 years ago. As to my condition, he's still working on me to make me what I ought to be.
Thank you.
So I can tell you tonight,
Every person in this building, starting with me, needs to get saved.
Amen.
Sometimes as preachers, sometimes I'll say to give it, if you need to be saved, if you need to get saved, come on down here. Well, that's every one of us. But if you've been saved, let me be very clear, you can't get saved again.
Amen.
See, that's what they do in the Pentecostal church and all those charismatic churches. That's what they do in the Catholic church. That's what they do in the Methodist church. You understand what I'm saying? All them people, they come down and get saved, and then they do something wrong. They come down and try to get saved again. They'll get baptized 10, 12, 15, 32 times in their life. They keep trying to get saved again. You cannot get saved again. But if you have been saved, you can be saved some more. And none of us needs to be saved again, but all of us need to be saved some more.
Amen.
I can tell you right now, I'm more saved now than I was 38 years ago.
Amen.
Are you more saved now than you were?
Amen.
That's how you know you really got saved.
Yes.
God don't give up. He don't stop. He keeps on saving. That's what Jesus is doing in heaven right now. He is saving unto the uttermost. Y'all get that? Unto the uttermost. I think I know a lot of people that just want to be a little bit saved.
Yeah, you're right.
You know anybody like that? They want to know how little salvation can I get and still go to heaven when I die. Here's how much of it you got to have. All of it.
Amen.
You cannot be a little bit saved.
Amen.
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 For 2,000 years, Jesus has been praying, interceding, mediating. As the minister in the sanctuary, Hebrews calls him, as the great high priest, as the advocate of his people, as the shepherd, as the bishop of his people, as our great mediator. He has kept us saved and continued doing his saving work in our life, working daily on our condition.
Bless his name. Hallelujah. Amen.
All right. So, his birth, life, death, burial, resurrection. Ascension and enthronement, that's finished, done. His ongoing work from the throne of God, that's unfinished and is still happening right now to save us to the uttermost. So these 16 gospel effects have a past effect, but they also have a present effect in our lives, right here, right now. But lastly, number three, I want you to see these 16 effects not only have a past effect and a present effect, they have a promised effect.
Yeah.
Or a future effect.
Yeah.
Okay. Because there's one of those gospel events that Christ has not done, but it's as good as doing. So much so that God has already credited to me as to my position. Are you listening?
Right.
I mean, you read over there in Romans chapter number 8, you know, where it said, as many as he did foreknow, he did predestinate. And them that he called, those that he called, he also justified. And those that he justified, he also glorified. Past tense, it's a done deal. Past tense, it's already happened, but it hadn't happened. But it has happened.
Right.
Remember what I said? 38 years ago when God saved me, got all 16 of them. Got all of them. As to my position.
Right.
Some of them I've been getting over the last 38 years and will, as long as the Lord leaves me here, as to my condition.
Okay. Yeah.
But there's one great work. There's one great gospel event.
Yeah.
Turn to Hebrews 9. One great gospel event left.
Right.
From the saving work of Jesus Christ. And it is that last and seventh work, his second coming, the return of the Lord.
Right. Yeah.
The return.
Yeah. Okay.
First five, those things are past.
Yeah.
Number six, the ascension and session, that is present, but the second coming is yet in the future. It's in the future. But watch this. going to take yet to save me as much as it takes the other six events.
Exactly right.
Hebrews chapter number 9. Notice, if you will, verse 24, 26, and then verse 28. Verse number 24. For Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Now notice the present tense on Jesus' ascension and session. Right now, N-O-W, he appears in the presence of God for us. Verse 26 says, so then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Now that's back yonder in the past.
Right.
That's what he did over those 33 years that he was here on the earth. Now I want you to notice, if you would please, verse number 28. It says, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin. Unto what? Unto salvation.
Amen.
Unto salvation.
Amen.
Amen.
What does it mean that he is going to appear the second time? It means that he had a first coming.
Amen.
And he did five things in his first coming. And then he ascended up to heaven. And he is appearing there, his first coming. That was his first appearing. He's making his second appearing in heaven for us, representing us there. But he is going to come now and make a final appearance, a final coming. And he's coming without sin, not to deal with sin. That's done. That's the finished work of Christ. The session is the unfinished work of Christ. But the second coming is the soon finished work of Christ. He is coming for our salvation. I said the past effect, Jesus' birth, his life, his death, burial, resurrection. Those were past effects. And they gave to me salvation that is eternal and spiritual. God save my spirit. But his session in heaven right now gives me a salvation that is internal and gradual. He's saving my soul right now. He saved my spirit 38 years ago. He's saving my soul right now. When he comes again, he's going to give me a salvation that is external. Are you listening to me? It is external and final. What's he coming back to save when he comes again? This body.
Amen.
This body, my body and your body, it ain't no more saved now than it was for the Lord's sake. You with me? My spirit is saved and can't be more saved. My soul is being saved. It is being saved. But when he comes, he is going to complete all seven gospel events and thus complete all of his saving work in my life. He's going to save this body. He is going to give me a glorified body.
Amen.
Without sin.
Amen.
Unto salvation.
Amen.
And when he comes, I'm going to be all the way saved.
Amen.
And when he comes, my position and my condition will be matched perfectly together. There